Hello and welcome to Forward Boldly. I'm Christine Niles. Did you know miracles have been wrought through the image of divine mercy? Actual miracles, and a lot of them, people's lives literally being saved through the image of divine mercy. Did you know the divine mercy image is not just a vessel of God's grace, but also a weapon of spiritual warfare? There are a number of examples, but I'm going to give you just a couple. And then I'm going to address some of the objections to the divine mercy devotion, so please stick around for that. But first, a word from our sponsor. If you're looking to buy or sell a home, please consider realestateforlife.org. They'll pair you with a faith-based realtor who shares your values, get you a great deal, and best of all, they'll give a cut of their commission to the pro-life group of your choice. And all this comes without costing you a single penny. I myself have used them twice. I was very pleased with both results. One time to sell my home, another time to buy a home. So I can personally vouch for them. They've got 1,400 trained professionals across the U.S. and Canada, so you can easily find one in your area. Just go to realestateforlife.org. That's realestateforlife.org. And please remember to let them know Christine Niles referred you. Each referral supports Stella Maris Media and helps us continue to do the work that we're doing. Again, that is realestateforlife.org, a great organization worth supporting. So in 2012, a man named Ron Ragelis was preparing for Hurricane Sandy. He lived in New London, Connecticut, and his house was within 200 yards of the beachfront. His neighborhood was ordered to evacuate, and so as Ron is getting his house ready, he has an image of divine mercy in his home. It's hanging on his wall. And this is what he writes. Quote, I walked out to the backyard veranda with the image in hand. With no rain or sea spray yet that could damage the image, I held it face up toward heaven and made the sign of the cross, with the image facing the direction of the oncoming storm. While I was making the sign of the cross, I began to recite the Divine Mercy Chaplet, using the same words in the diary that St. Faustina prayed to turn back the avenging angel who was about to strike the earth. I then returned the image to the mantelpiece, locked the front door, and left. So when he was allowed to return to his home 2 days later, the damage to the neighborhood was massive. There were downed trees and electrical wires, basement floodings, roof collapses, debris everywhere, tons of displaced beach sand. But guess what? No damage to Ron's property. None. Not even basement flooding. Nothing. In fact, the storm literally stopped at his property line. He could see where the beach sand and debris ended, and it was right there at his property line. His neighbor also confirmed that. According to Ron, quote, I believe with 100% certainty that Jesus, via the image of divine mercy and invoked with the chaplet, protected my property. In the divine mercy image, we see Jesus' foot stepping toward us and his right hand raised in blessing. Jesus calls us to respond to him as he steps toward us. With his arm raised in blessing, he gives us the grace to act in trust. Do you all remember the Maui fire from last year? It killed more than 100 people. It destroyed 2,200 buildings, cost $5.5 billion in damage. It was all over the news. Do you remember that story about the Catholic Church that was miraculously spared? You could see all the trees and surrounding buildings, you know, flattened or totally charred black, burnt to a rubble from the fires. And yet the church, which was called Maria Lanakila in Lahaina, which stands for Our Lady of Victory, remained untouched. And you know what's interesting? Wyola Church, a historic 200-year-old Protestant church whose grave held the bodies of Hawaiian royalty, literally a few blocks down the street, you can look it up on Google Maps, was totally burnt to the ground. Nothing but black rubble. Literally just down the street from Maria Lanakila, which was, again, untouched. You can see it. You know what else is interesting? Here is Father Chris Alar of the Marians of the Immaculate Conception on these Maui fires in that particular church.
There was a bunch of pictures taken that they enthroned the image of divine mercy in this church shortly before the fires. And that this image of divine mercy was from Poland and it was enthroned in the church. Now remember, Jesus made several promises through this image. I'd like to read you the words that Blessed Michael Sopochko wrote. He said, quote, "When chastisements for sins come upon the world, and your own country will experience utter degradation, the only refuge will be trust in my mercy. I will protect the cities and homes in which the divine mercy image is found."
Another miracle, this one during World War II, and Father Alar once again.
Now, there was another incident, check this out, during World War II, also in Warsaw, Poland. The Gestapo had sectioned off several blocks in the town, and they were detaining all the residents so that they could be identified and sent to concentration camps. One man asked the officer in charge if he could go back to his apartment to get some gold, I believe it was. He wanted to get something, and the Nazis must have thought, okay, we'll let him think he can get it for himself, but then we'll probably take it, whatever it was that he asked to get. He ran back and found what he was looking for, a tiny little image of divine mercy, which probably would have been the one I just showed you. When he returned with the image, the officer was gone, and they had moved on with all the other detainees, basically had forgotten about him. Now, this man was a judge, and since the Nazis first eliminated all educated people, he definitely would have been sent to the concentration camp and exterminated. There's no question. You know who this man was? He became a Marian of the Immaculate Conception. In 1948, after the war, this man joined the Marians. Father Julian Krajewski, he dedicated the rest of his life because of that event to spreading divine mercy. And he is a Marian of the Immaculate Conception. That is incredible. I love these kind of stories.
So amazing. So in addition to being a vessel of God's grace, something our Lord explicitly told St. Faustina, the divine mercy image, like I said, is also a weapon of spiritual warfare. It wards off evil. It protects. Here's another example. This is one coming out of Nigeria about a woman who was being threatened by gang members because she wouldn't agree to their corruption. She apparently worked in the government. She wouldn't agree to corruption, corrupt deals and bribery, which involved criminal gangs. And so she started receiving death threats at her home. So she prayed to God and she decided to place the divine mercy image facing out on every single window of her home. One day she's at home. She hears motorcycles, vehicles outside, and it's the gang members. They're there to kill her. They take out rifles and they just shoot up the entire length of her home, just up and down, everywhere, bullet spray everywhere. So she hits the floor, of course, she's screaming, thinks she's gonna die, she's praying. The shooting stops, they, you know, think they've done their job, they leave. She survives and she calls the police and they all document this. They come up, they see these divine mercy images facing outward in all the windows. They see the shell casings everywhere, you know, all over the place on her front yard. But not a single window with the divine mercy image broken. Not a single one. If that's not a miracle, I don't know what is. And then there's the miracle on the Hudson, about the plane landing on the Hudson River in New York in 2009. I'm actually not going to go into the details. You can look it up. But so many miracles, so many testimonies from people through the image of divine mercy. I have my own testimony about how the Divine Mercy Chaplet and image wrought about spiritual miracles in the life of my late aunt, Luana. So Luana was my favorite aunt. She was the younger sister of my mother. She had a wonderful sense of humor. She was always joking when we were around, and we'd come visit her home a lot, and she would always cook for us. She would make lasagna for us. I loved her lasagna. She would make it like once a week for us. I loved it. And sadly, she led a somewhat tragic life. First of all, she was never baptized. She never received, as far as I know, a single sacrament in the church throughout her whole life, never. And the father of her son abandoned her when the son was still a little baby. So she was forced to raise her son as a single mother. And unfortunately, she was always looking for love, you know, as they say, in all the wrong places, with men who didn't really truly value her. Like I said, she'd never been baptized, never received the sacraments at all. And later in life, towards the end of her life, she developed throat cancer. It progressed to the point where she was dying. And we knew that her time was coming near. And at the time, I was living in Indiana. My children were very young at that time. And we decided to make a road trip all the way down to Florida, which is where she lived, South Florida, to say goodbye to her, you know, one last time, because we knew she didn't have much time left. So we went down there. We spent about a week down in Florida, and I'd come over to visit her, talk with her. She was having a really difficult time talking. She had to have her wound cleaned several times a day, and I remember seeing it once. They had a bandage on her all the time, and they had to change the bandage. And, I mean, it was just a huge gaping wound right here. I mean, the cancer was just eating through her throat. So it was just wide open, gaping wound. It was just, yeah. And what I would do is I would come over with my children. And at that time, there was an actual hospital bed in her living room. That's where she was resting most of the time. It was in that living room. There's a TV there. So she spent a lot of time watching TV, just kind of lying there resting. And I took a little image of Divine Mercy. It was like, I think it was like this small. And I placed it at the end of her bed on the wall, okay, so facing her. And she'd never been particularly religious in her life, ever. But she gave me permission to do this. And she also gave us permission to kneel at her bed, at the side of her bed, you know, with me and my children. And we would recite the Divine Mercy Chaplet. And we did that every day that we were there. Every day we'd come by. And while she's watching TV, right, we would just kneel there and quietly pray the Divine Mercy Chaplet. And then we had to leave. And I remember being on the phone with my mother because we knew that her time was coming near. And I absolutely insisted with my mother, "Mom, you have got to get her a Catholic priest. You've got to get her a Catholic priest." Even though part of our family was Buddhist and we have another, you know, the other part is Catholic. Obviously, my side of the family was Catholic. And we had Buddhist relatives who were insisting that she had, you know, last rites according to Buddhism. And I was telling my mom, "Mom, you've got to get her a Catholic priest. We've got to give her a Catholic funeral." And so she was, and here's the amazing thing, okay? This, her whole life, never having been baptized, you know, living life far away from God, never going to church, like I said, never receiving the sacraments. And yet, this is what happened, okay, in her final days. My mother was able to secure a Catholic priest. Guess what hour he comes to her house? 3 p.m., the hour of Divine Mercy. And I explained to the priest that she'd never been baptized. And so the priest had a talk with her and asked her, "Do you want to be baptized?" She said yes. She received baptism, which, as we know, completely cleanses the soul. Completely cleanses the soul of all stain of sin. He offers Mass there in her home. So she receives Holy Communion in the state of grace for the first time ever in her life. Her marriage was also convalidated because towards the end of her life, she got civilly married to a man who's actually very good to her. They had their marriage convalidated right then and there, and then she received extreme unction. So right there, four sacraments of the church. And then she died just a few weeks later. Absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. And I attribute much of that to the prayers of Divine Mercy and that Divine Mercy image. That Divine Mercy image, so many graces flow just through having that image, just through having that image in your house. So many graces flow. It's amazing. And we take it for granted. You know, we take it for granted. We just kind of like leave it around the house or whatever. We bury it in our holy cards and don't think about it. And our Lord promised St. Faustina that he would shower the world with graces through that image. And I believe very much that that image, having that image in my aunt's home and our praying every single day next to her bedside, that absolutely played a part in this amazing shower of graces that she received at the end of her life. How amazing God is, how good he is. So she died in the state of grace, and I look forward, God willing, to seeing her one day in heaven. So if you could remember her in your prayers, her name is Luana. Please pray for her soul. It is my firm belief that the message of Divine Mercy is one of the most powerful, most important messages of the 21st century. So why do certain people oppose it? Well, first, you need to understand the central theme of Divine Mercy is God's love and his mercy. So from the Diary of Divine Mercy, section 1273, these are revelations of our Lord to St. Faustina. And this book has been fully approved by the church. This is what he told her. I am love and mercy itself. There is no misery that could be a match for my mercy. Neither will misery exhaust it, because as it is being granted, it increases. That mercy is primarily found in the sacrament of penance, in confession. The message of divine mercy heavily promotes confession. So section 1602 says, when you approach the confessional, know this, that I myself am waiting there for you. I'm only hidden by the priest, but I myself act in your soul. Here, the misery of the soul meets the God of mercy. Tell souls that from this fount of mercy, souls draw graces solely with a vessel of trust. If their trust is great, there is no limit to my generosity. It goes on to note, the torrent of grace inundates humble souls. The proud remain always in poverty and misery because my grace turns away from them to humble souls. So repentance, confession, mercy, love, these are the core themes of divine mercy. And Father Aylar has said divine mercy is an extension of and an expansion of the beautiful message of the Sacred Heart. And as you know, that originated in France in the 1600s in revelations given to St. Margaret Mary Alacoque and propagated with the help of her spiritual director, St. Claude de la Colombière. And one of the revelations our Lord said to St. Faustina was the, like I said, the very famous image of divine mercy. He promised that through that image, he would pour out an abundance of graces on the whole world, especially those who keep an image of it in their homes. I want you to take a look at this because this is amazing. The divine mercy image perfectly matches up with the image on the Shroud of Turin. It is a perfect match when it comes to facial features, bone structure, nose length, and other facial aspects. It's amazing. Okay, it's divinely ordained. And it's important to note as well, for those who doubt it, the Divine Mercy devotion has the highest level of papal approval possible. In the year 2000, Pope John Paul II canonized St. Faustina, through whom these revelations came. He also elevated Divine Mercy Sunday, which is the Sunday after Easter, to a feast day with indulgences attached. And then, this is beautiful too, he actually died on April 2nd of 2005. That was during the octave of Easter, okay? On a Marian Saturday, as we know, Pope John Paul II had a tremendous devotion to Our Lady, and on the Vigil of Divine Mercy Sunday, of which he was the chief propagator, played an absolutely crucial role in propagating the Divine Mercy message. So again, why do certain people hate this devotion so much? Well, there are different reasons, depending on which group of Catholics you're talking to. There's one group that totally rejects what they call the Novus Ordo Church, anything that is post-Vatican II. So for instance, they reject the validity of Pope John Paul II as Pope. As we know, like I said, Pope John Paul II was instrumental in bringing about not only the canonization of St. Faustina, a fellow Polish Catholic, but also the promotion and spread of the Divine Mercy devotion. And it's believed that the Diary of Divine Mercy actually predicted his pontificate. In section 1732, it says, quote, from her, meaning Poland, will come forth a spark that will prepare the world for my final coming. And Pope John Paul II is believed to be that spark mentioned, the first Polish pope in the history of the world. That's something that we need to, you know, those of us who take for granted Pope John Paul II, you have to understand when he stepped out onto that loggia in Rome and his name was revealed as the next pope, people were kind of thunderstruck, okay? Because they had never, in the history of the world, ever had a Polish pontiff. Plenty of Italians, hundreds and hundreds of Italians, but a Polish pope? A pope from Poland? Never.
This name didn't even sound Italian.
Wojtyła.
Karol Wojtyła of Poland, the first non-Italian pope in more than 4.5 centuries. The papal name he had chosen, John Paul II. One Italian asked for his impression by a Vatican radio reporter summed up the feeling of many. He said, After so many Italian popes, it takes a while to get used to the idea. The new Bishop of Rome, he said, speaking of himself, has been called from a distant land, yet it is a land nearby in terms of communion and of faith in Christian traditions.
It was a very unique moment in the history of the church. But returning to these critics of Divine Mercy, here's what the website Novus Ordo Watch says. Quote, clearly the Divine Mercy is the Novus Ordo devotion, almost a purported heavenly endorsement of John Paul II and his teachings, and thus the entire Novus Ordo religion, as they say with a disdainful sniff. There are people, there are Catholics who don't believe Pope John Paul II is a canonized saint. Even though church decorations on canonizations are arguably infallible, these people would rather question the church or magisterium than ever admit that any action taken by the so-called Novus Ordo Church or post-Vatican II Church could ever possibly be valid. And then you have the other group of Catholics who do believe Pope John Paul II was a valid pope. They do believe the post-Vatican II Church is valid, but they have concerns about some of the revelations in the Diary of Divine Mercy. The Diary of Divine Mercy was actually placed on the Index of Forbidden Books in 1959, and that prohibition was lifted on April 15th of 1978. And what's interesting is this was actually predicted in the Diary of Divine Mercy. In section 378, it says, there will come a time when this work of mercy, which God is demanding so very much, will be as though utterly undone. And then God will act with great power, which will give evidence of its authenticity. It will be a new splendor for the church, although it has been dormant in it from long ago. So why exactly was it placed on the index? Because of mistranslations of the original Polish into Italian. And that mistranslation contained very clear theological errors. In fact, the translation was so bad, for example, that in one segment where our Lord says, I am love and mercy itself, I read you the quote earlier in entry 1074, the Italian translation actually said that St. Faustina said that about herself. So yeah, no wonder the book was placed on the Index of Forbidden Books if that's how bad the translation was. So a more accurate translation was later undertaken, and all of the theological objections vanished, and that's why it was removed from the index. Now, there are people who continue to lodge objections, people who continue to think that even with the accurate translation, there are heresies or there are concerns. One of them, for instance, is some lodge the claim that Divine Mercy preaches unconditional mercy with no price to be paid, no obligations, nothing. In other words, that Divine Mercy preaches cheap grace. Okay, anyone who's actually read the diary, and I have from cover to cover at least once, if not more, you know that this is totally false. If you've actually read the Diary of Divine Mercy, and rather than just going on what people say about it, 100% false. It is so ignorant of the message of Divine Mercy for anyone to even make that claim that I have a hard time believing any person of goodwill could make that claim, okay? If you've actually read it. If you haven't read it and you're just going off what other people are saying, you're just completely mistaken. St. Faustina's life was filled with suffering, constant suffering offered up on behalf of souls. She understood the price to be paid for sin. She offered her whole life up as an oblation to satisfy the justice of God. Why? In order to bring about mercy for sinners. She understood there is a price to be paid for sin, and she paid that price through her suffering. There is no cheap grace in the world of Divine Mercy. And St. Faustina knew that better than most. And also the entire Divine Mercy devotion is about finding God's mercy specifically in the confessional. I mean, it's all over the place. Go to confession, go to confession, go to confession. That's the message of our Lord in Divine Mercy. It's like the heart of this message. So anyone who walks away without this understanding either didn't read the diary, or they didn't pay attention, or they're willfully blind, or they're just flat out lying. In which case, may God have mercy on your soul for blocking the spread of his grace and mercy through this beautiful and powerful divinely ordained devotion. Now, I said in my last podcast on Divine Mercy last year that people who are lodging these objections and causing other people to doubt and all that stuff, or even making claims that it's heretical and we shouldn't follow it at all. These people, whether wittingly or unwittingly, are doing the work of Satan. Satan would like nothing more than to suppress, impede, and block the message of God's mercy. And one of the ways he's doing it is through spreading misinformation and outright lies about the divine mercy devotion, especially through clergy and laity who, quite frankly, should know better and can't be bothered to do their homework. And they're just repeating misinformation. So a lot of people got mad at me when I said this last time, about doing the work of Satan. If you have private doubts, fine, work out those private doubts with God. Do some research, read, about the objections, and then read about the responses to the objections. Because I think all the objections are very easily debunked. If you give a charitable reading rather than committing rash judgment, then all of the objections are easily debunked. St. Faustina, again, she was among the saints given a terrifying vision of hell. Very vivid, very terrifying. She was given to know that many people fall into hell over sins of the flesh. Also that many people in hell are there who did not believe in the existence of hell while they were alive on earth. So the message of mercy is not about mercy without obligations or consequences. I mean, it's ridiculous that people even say that. So another objection, okay, is to specific passages, like the one in which our Lord says to St. Faustina that he unites himself more intimately to her than to any other creature. So people start screaming, oh, that's heresy. How can she say that? He united himself more intimately to Our Lady. Our Lady was most intimately united to him. How dare St. Faustina try to usurp Mary's role? Heresy. Well, it's obvious to those who spend 2 seconds thinking about this that the passage means that God was uniting himself more intimately to St. Faustina than any other creature at that particular time. Not more than any other creature ever who has lived in the history of the world. I mean, I don't know why. This is very obvious to me, and it's very obvious to other people. I don't know why it's not obvious to people who lodge these objections. Another objection. In 1937, our Lord said to St. Faustina, for your sake, I'm going to bless the world. And so critics say, oh, well, World War II came 2 years later. Poland was massively punished 2 years later. How's that God blessing the world? See, this is fake. This is false. Just because God blessed the world in 1937 with extra graces of conversion doesn't mean those blessings would remain for all time or even for a year after. In fact, World War II was actually predicted in the Diary of Divine Mercy. She predicted the destruction of Warsaw and the massive devastation of the country of Poland. And why? It's very interesting. Primarily because Poland was one of the abortion capitals of Europe at the time. And according to St. Faustina, what was revealed to her, God's anger burned against the Polish people for killing their unborn children. A truly wicked and evil act. So, there's most definitely the understanding that without prayers and sacrifices made in reparation to the divine heart, that God's justice will rain down on us. And that is exactly what happened, as we know, in World War II. St. Faustina died in 1938, almost exactly a year before Hitler's blitzkrieg of September 1st, 1939, when he invaded Poland with 1 million German troops, thus marking the start of World War II. As we know, the Nazis absolutely devastated the country of Poland. They planted 457 concentration camps all throughout Poland. Poland was ground zero for these concentration camps, as well as the world's most famous death camps, Auschwitz, Treblinka, others. But even after World War II ended, Poland continued to suffer, this time under a communist regime. And as we know, it was under this communist regime that Pope John Paul II grew up. And we also know that later on, as Pope, he would almost single-handedly help to bring down communism in Poland. He also worked hand-in-hand with President Ronald Reagan, fighting to bring down communism in the Soviet Union. All right, let's move on to another objection. In one passage of the diary, our Lord says to St. Faustina, from today on, do not fear God's judgment, for you will not be judged. So once again, people cry, heresy! That's St. Faustina would think she's exempt from judgment. How dare she? Well, first, it's not St. Faustina saying that about herself. It's our Lord. And second, if you live a life of extraordinary holiness, which she did, and you remain in the state of grace until death, which she did, and you go straight to heaven, which I'm pretty sure she did, you are indeed exempt from judgment. She is, after all, a canonized saint. The church has declared her so. She lived a life of extraordinary holiness. She died in the state of grace. She was indeed exempt from God's judgment and death. And this was just a remarkable revelation that God gave to her, which he can do if he wants to. He can do anything he wants. And occasionally he will reveal to his saints, you know, special graces and favors that he is bestowing upon them. And he clearly gave her a special grace in, you know, preserving her in the state of grace. He bestowed a special grace upon Saint Thérèse of Lisieux. It was revealed to her when she made a general confession to a priest when she was an adult that she had never once in her entire life committed a single mortal sin. That was a special grace bestowed upon her by God, which the vast majority of humankind cannot claim. And when she learned that from the priest, she wasn't proud of herself. She gave all the glory to God because she knew that she didn't merit any of this. This was simply God's grace bestowed upon her. And that's how humble, holy people respond. All right, another passage that people object to. Quote, "And the host came out of the tabernacle and came to rest in my hands, and I with joy placed it back in the tabernacle. This was repeated a second time, and I did the same thing. Despite this, it happened a third time." So critics scoff at this. They say, this is preposterous. Why would the host come out of the tabernacle to rest in St. Faustina's hands? How ridiculous. Why would she place the sacred host back in the tabernacle multiple times? They think the whole thing's preposterous. Well, laying aside the possibility that this may have been a vision, what is so strange about this actually happening? What's so strange about it? Our Lord has done strange things in the past that seem strange to us, that probably won't make sense till we get to the other side. For instance, Our Lady asked Saint Bernadette to dig up the soil at the grotto and eat the dirt. People thought she was crazy. St. Francis of Assisi, he stripped himself naked, literally naked in the town square, and declared his total devotion to God, and then went off and lived a very holy life, forming his own community. You know, stranger things have happened. So why couldn't God do this as a sign of his special favor and love for St. Faustina? He clearly had a special love for her because she loved him so much, and she showed it through her actions, through her sufferings, through humility. Why couldn't he do this? He could. Anyway, there are other objections as well, but the show's already going on too long, and I recommend going to divinemercy.org to read responses to critiques of Divine Mercy. And all the critiques, like I said, are very easily debunked. Please do not let these, quite frankly, shallow objections prevent you from taking full advantage of Divine Mercy. That's exactly what the enemy wants. Like I already talked about, there are demonstrable miracles through the image of Divine Mercy. Spiritual miracles, physical miracles. Please have images blessed and set up in your home. Have images placed facing outward on your doors or windows. Above all, if you have not been to confession in a while, please go. So I'll close with a message from our Lord in the Diary of Divine Mercy. This is from 1146. "Let the greatest sinners place their trust in my mercy. They have the right before others to trust in the abyss of my mercy. Souls that make an appeal to my mercy delight me. To such souls, I grant even more graces than they ask." 1578, "The graces of my mercy are drawn by the means of one vessel only, and that is trust. The more a soul trusts, the more it will receive." So the Sunday after Easter is the great feast of Divine Mercy. It's such a tremendous grace for the church and for the world. Please get right with God if you're not. And if you are right with God, please spend the day praising his mercy, loving him and thanking him, and asking him to pour out his mercy upon the whole world. There's an entire world out there that's lost, confused, desperate, in need of hope. Be that light, be that hope to this lost world. And pray. Pray that they come to know that light, that true light that leads the way to heaven, our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for watching and listening, and in the words of Saint Joan of Arc, in God's name, forward boldly.